It is a unique organization that has been bringing together states, government agencies, hundreds of NGOs, as well as thousands of experts and scientists for decades. The International Union for the Conservation of Nature, the IUCN, has helped more than 75 countries in the application of their conservation and biological diversity strategies. Africa, which each year loses up to 350 million hectares of land due to soil degradation, is a major source for the IUCN, as Charles Karangwa, one of its officials, shared with me. I met him on the sidelines of COP27 in Sharm el-Sheikh in Egypt. Charles Karangwa, hello. Welcome on Initiative Africa. So you are a regional head of land systems covering forests, drylands and sustainable agriculture at the IUCN, the International Union for Conservation of Nature, Africa region. Could you tell us about the role and mission of the IUCN?
Thank you. IUCN is a global authority on conservation, and we are probably the largest network of conservation organizations across the world. And most of our work really spans through four components. Conserving nature, of course, people, livelihoods, alternatives, and equity and rights, which is part of governance work we do. And we also have quite a lot of work around biodiversity from both terrestrial and marine ecosystems in Africa. And mostly also working with governments to transition towards sustainable and climate resilience development.
What about the work of IUCN in Africa?
So IUCN in Africa have probably for many decades been supporting conservation agenda. And over the last 30 years, we have been mostly focusing on work on what we call sustainable conservation, which basically includes issues around development. So you are basically looking at drivers of deforestation and habitat loss, and by addressing them, then you basically respond to conservation challenges. So our work in Africa, we have about four major programs. One is focusing on what we call protected area and conserved area. And here it's really institutional capacity development for governments, protected area managers to be able to sustainably manage, conserve biodiversity. The second is on what we call terrestrial land management ecosystems. And this covers spans around basically forest, agriculture, drylands, resilience, water systems management, which basically helps also institutions, communities to sustainably manage and invest in those ecosystems in a way that, of course, both are sustainable but also are productive, because these are the resources that people depend on every day. The third element of our work in Africa is around marine and the coastal resilience. We have experienced over the last decade huge changes in marine ecosystem management, disasters, flooding, which is really hugely costing the continent a lot in terms of resources. And what we are trying to do is really to increase sustainable management of the coastal area, but also the marine. So which includes also plastic pollution in the marine areas, waste management and the likes. And then finally, of course, is our work on policy and institutional capacity development across the continent. So that's where we are working in Africa.
Could you talk about nature-based solutions? What are they and how can they benefit the African continent in the fight against climate change?
Yeah, thank you. I think over the last couple of years, we have seen actually a huge interest in nature-based solutions. And last year, actually early this year in April, the United Nations Environmental Assembly, UNEA 5, endorsed the definition of nature-based solutions as basically actions to restore, protect, and conserve nature. All type of ecosystems, terrestrial ecosystems, marine ecosystems, and that was actually an official way and a call to action for governments to start adopting nature-based solutions. And you can also talk about biodiversity loss at the same time. You look at the drivers of biodiversity loss and wonder how do you put something together which can address both climate change from adaptation and mitigation, but also biodiversity loss in many ways. The nature-based solutions is probably one of the best way, because you're talking about not one solution. You're talking about the solutions based on nature. And in Africa, of course, I will speak from, let's take an example of energy. When we talk about renewable energy, you are mostly relying on a number of sources, right? You are talking about the wind, transitioning to wind, to solar, to other renewables. And most of this really depends on nature. Now, how do you really build nature to be able to give you that renewable energy you're looking for? An example is a hydropower plant. If you don't protect a catchment upstream, and you're building a huge hydroelectricity power plant downstream, what happens is you lose the investment because you're not protecting the catchment. And the way you protect catchment, you are using the nature-based solutions. You are managing land sustainably. You are increasing vegetation cover. You are protecting soil erosions. You are basically investing in nature so that nature can give you the services.
Do you have some concrete examples of IUCN's work in Africa about these nature-based solutions?
I want to do that, yeah. One example, I have been working over the last 4 or 5 years on a program which is funded by the Netherlands Ministry of Foreign Affairs through their embassy in Rwanda, where we invested in protecting an 18,000 hectare of catchment. Let me tell you a story about this catchment. This is a catchment which historically, at least every single year, about 100 people's lives were being lost because of landslides, because of floods. Huge losses from infrastructure, including bridge, roads, were being destroyed because upstream was not protected. And during the heavy rain, Rwanda is a country of 1,000 hills, so you have a very high slope of 60%. And when it rains, because of the type of the soil and the construct of the landscape, there is always that whole landslide. I remember witnessing a time when a family of 8 people completely got exterminated because of a landslide, a heavy landslide. So we invested in that through different natural and nature-based solutions approach, including, of course, restoration of that catchment, protecting the river, increasing the size of the where the river can flow, but also doing some other terracing of mountains to reduce the intensity of water. And I was very pleased early this month to speak with the mayor of the city of Rubavu in the western of Rwanda, saying for the first time in 5 years, we have not lost a life, we have not lost a road, we have not lost a house, we have the normal rains. It was a very good to hear that story. So nature-based solution works. So with that project, we created 60,000 jobs, green jobs, for very, very poor households that have been able to work, to restore, to protect the land, and they were paid as part of the ecosystem service benefits.
What about forest landscape restoration in Africa? Agriculture is a major driver of degradation due to land conversion. How can we reconcile restoration with agriculture and farming?
One of the unfortunate challenge people face in Africa is that they think agriculture should compete with forest. But that's not true, because historically Africa lived and survived on land, people survived on farming without necessarily destroying nature. I think there is a whole pressure and misconception of agricultural sector, thinking that expansion and expanding is going to be giving us more food security, but actually it's worsening the food security for many reasons. And that's probably one of the factors that we need to address in Africa when we talk about forest landscape restoration. And since agriculture is a huge driver of deforestation, the major investment we are making in Africa is really agroforestry systems. Investing in agroforestry, basically trees mixed with the crops, because then you are increasing vegetation cover and forest cover, but also you are reducing soil erosion and increasing the soil carbon matter by just mixing trees and the crops at the same time on farm. But also, we are encouraging farmers to not just expand agriculture, but sustainably manage the land they have, by increasing regenerative agriculture on farm. And then finally, of course, it's restoring what has been already lost and try to invest in protecting what is still intact by not expanding agricultural area further.
Wood burning for heating and cooking is a major source of emissions and a health hazard for many. Some populations don't have many options, and it's sometimes a cultural choice. What can be done here?
I think that's very right. In terms of numbers, 85% of Africans use firewood for cooking and heating the house and lighting. Even in some communities, they still use even firewood for lighting in the house. So it's a very useful resources. And that's one of the major drivers. If you go to countries like Malawi, the major driver in addition to agriculture is of course use of charcoal and firewood. But do we have alternatives? I think you can't turn this situation around for just in a year or 2 years or 3 years. You need to find how do we start investing in other options that can help reduce the biomass use at household level. There's a number of options that are being explored in many countries. IUCN is working on a number of projects in Rwanda, in Malawi, in Kenya, for example, to support communities access low fuel use cooking stoves, what we call improved cooking stoves. You still use biomass, you still use charcoal, you still use wood, but you don't use the same quantity as what you could use in a normal traditional stove. That's very important. The second, we are investing significantly in technologies. IUCN is supporting, for example, different countries in Africa to study carefully alternative or what we call improved biomass technologies, but also green charcoal. And the third option we are investing in is what we call sustainable forest management techniques, increase the forest productivity. Now, if you want to reduce deforestation, you increase the forest productivity by improving forest management. And that's one of the areas we are investing in as an organization to basically try to increase forest productivity and then increase the cubic meter of biomass per hectare, then reduce a complete degradation of existing forests, especially natural forests.
Climate and energy transition are critical for everyone and the planet as well. How do you see progress in this field on the continent, knowing that pathways for a just net zero transition must reflect African realities and ambitions? How can we make sure to guide fair and effective policy decisions? What are your thoughts?
Yeah, good question. One of the contentious topics in the COP here is, of course, Africa is a less contributor to emissions, right? So you're talking about less than 3% globally. And if you ask Africa to transition to green energy, there might be a mixed feeling of, okay, in any case, we are not emitting a lot, but why do we want to change from our coal to, why do you want to ask us to close our coal to go to other renewable, sustainable energy? So I think it's an interesting topic for discussion, but I would provide a real situation here. No one would ever wish Africa to be where Europe and China and other developed countries are today. We would want to prevent to be there, right? So we would want to invest in sustainable energy now than just waiting until the situation is worse. So I guess that's where policies need to change. And we are seeing a lot of interest of a continent in Africa of change and just transition to sustainable and renewable energies. But of course, it's not something that can just happen overnight, right? Africa needs more time. I think Africa has a huge opportunity for sustainable energy. We are a continent with many sources of hydro rivers, huge potential. We can develop and serve the entire world with our rivers, with hydro, but also solar. But I guess what is needed is those resources, financial resources, to transition to those opportunities and tap into the natural ecosystem services that we have and embrace that sustainable energy transition.